So today's the topic is a clinical approach to uro infections. As you all know that my emphasis is on clinical approach, because the theory part, you can always read syndromes, you can read many of the etiopathogenesis, microscopy and all those things. But what ultimately is important is when you see a patient, how do you approach and how do you solve the issue and how do you manage? I mean, that is what is most important. Of course, in your examination, you need to remember all those syndromes and all that. As I keep telling in my Wednesday class, examination is like a marriage. It's a one-time event. But the real life starts after marriage. So the MD examination you pass, after that, suddenly you become a consultant. Then you should know how to approach each patient's problem and how to solve, and not to forget, try to remember the treatable conditions and look for that. I mean, there's no point in making a diagnosis of motor neuron disease or Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Even if you miss that, it makes no difference, though it will be given in the examination, because we have to see so many physical signs. But please remember to check always treatable conditions. Now, neuroinfection is one such clinical situation where there is a definite treatment available in certain types of neuroinfections. So the emphasis will be to look for those. Neuroinfection means it is an infection of the brain, that is encephalitis, infection of the meninges, meningitis, or usually a combination of the two, meningoencephalitis. Now, what is encephalopathy and what is encephalitis? Pathy means a disorder. Disorder function of the brain is encephalopathy. Usually they are non-inflammatory causes, whereas itis is an inflammation, usually due to an infection. Now, how do you distinguish meningitis and encephalitis? Whenever the primary manifestation is a meningeal involvement, now the classically, the meninges being a very, very pain-sensitive structures, severe headache because of the infection, fever, vomiting, and neck stiffness. So as long as the symptoms are limited to headache, fever, vomiting, neck stiffness, it is only meningitis. When the infection spreads from meninges to the cortical mantle, then the cerebral symptoms will come in. Now, what are the cerebral symptoms? Altered sensorium, seizures, and a neurological deficit. So please remember, you can distinguish meningitis from encephalitis as long as meninges is separately clinical features of headache, fever, vomiting, neck stiffness. But those people who come for acute encephalitis or acute meningitis, usually it is a combination of the two. Now, within the encephalitis, there can be a global encephalitis, that means where both the hemispheres are simultaneously involved, or it can be focal encephalitis like herpes simplex. What is the importance of knowing this? Because majority of the focal encephalitis have a treatable condition, while majority of the global encephalitis do not have any specific treatment. Then we have meningitis, and we are not dealing with the spinal cord today. The acute infections are due to bacterial, viral, parasitic, subacute are due to fungal, parasitic, and bacteria. Now, whenever an encephalon or a brain matter is involved, there are a set of symptoms and signs. Altered behavior, seizures, altered sensorium, and there may be a neurodeficit, and ultimately the altered sensorium goes into coma. So this group of signs and symptoms are very important manifestation that the cerebral parenchyma is involved. To repeat again, altered behavior, altered sensorium, seizures, and then neurodeficit. So when a patient has meningitis, next morning you find he has thrown a seizure, that means definitely the brain parenchyma is involved, because meninges per se cannot produce a seizure. The commonest cause of encephalitis, as you know, is a viral encephalitis, including the present day COVID-19, followed by bacterial, fungal, and now the treatable condition, autoimmune encephalitis. The prodromal of acute encephalitis of viral nature is like any other flu, fever, headache, body pain and all. The moment the brain is involved, this same set of symptoms, disoriented, confused, then alters sensorium, coma and seizures. Focal encephalitis, very, very important point in focal encephalitis is patient is conscious, whereas here the patient is unconscious or altered sensorium. So whenever you find behavioral or personality changes, focal seizures in the focal dystonia, remember it is a focal encephalitis and some of them are eminently treatable conditions. So just making an encephalitis diagnosis is not sufficient. You have to see whether it is a focal or not. So focal encephalitis has a lesion and a specific treatment is available. Now, how do you differentiate generalized encephalitis from focal? The onset in generalized is acute onset, while it is subacute. Focal encephalitis is subacute. Clinical features, I told you, in general it is unconscious, whereas here it is fully conscious with personality changes. Seizures are also focal. Neurodeficit is very prominent here. What are the common causes of focal encephalitis? Herpes simplex viral infections, autoimmune and paraneoplastic conditions. In generalized encephalitis, we have dengue, West Nile. JE has become less now because of the vaccination schedule. In generalized encephalitis, we do not have any specific treatment, whereas here it is a specific treatment. Acute viral encephalitis is short-lived, whereas this disease here unfolds over a period of several weeks. So I think you must be very careful to make a diagnosis of focal encephalitis because it is a treatable condition. Now, what are the encephalitis investigations? In addition to the routine, there are only three specific tests in neuroinfections. Only three specific tests in neuroinfection. Out of them, the two of them are very important. One is MR brain, plane and contrast. Why contrast? Because contrast is important in all inflammatory infective pathologies because there is a blood-brain barrier, the vascular permeability is increased. So the contrast enhances a lesion. If there is a tuberculoma, if there is a herpes encephalitis, you may be able to see better after a contrast. So when you ask for investigation, please ask for MR brain, plane and contrast. And then the CSF examination, which is the most important topic for today's neuroinfection. That is the CSF examination, which tells us, yes, there is an involvement of an infective pathology. EEG is not that much of an importance, but it is part and parcel of an investigative technique. But remember, it is the MR brain and CSF, which is very important. Now, some clinical scenarios. A 28-year-old male comes to a casualty with severe headache, fever, and vomiting. Now, question is it a neuroinfection? Or is it just a systemic viral infection? How do you make out? Look for meningeal signs and cerebral localizing signs and symptoms. So if you find the patient has a mild weakness of right upper limb, or on inquiry, you find the patient had one seizure, because they won't come and tell you about the seizure, you will have to elicit the story. Then obviously we are looking into a neuroinfection and not just a systemic viral infection. Another scenario, a 65-year-old male, diabetic, fever for 4 days and altered sensorium, no seizures and no focal deficit. Now, this is a very tricky situation. There is a fever and altered sensorium. Altered sensorium means there is an involvement of brain parenchyma. Now, is this encephalitis or is it encephalopathy secondary to system infection? Remember, senior citizens, when they come with fever and altered sensorium, you may do a MR brain, you may do a CSF, which is normal. They have a urinary tract infection or a pneumonitic patch. Because of the infection elsewhere, the patient goes into an altered sensorium. It is not a direct infection. So, because once there is a direct infection, then you will have to give heavy dose of antibiotics. But if there is no direct infection, then the underlying cause for infection is all that is to be treated. Normally, the encephalopathies which many of physicians will see are the metabolic encephalopathies, hepatic renal dysfunction, hyponatremia, very common. Occasionally you see endocrine, very, very rarely Wernicke's. Hypoxic ischemic, very common nowadays. Somebody comes with a heart attack, with a cardiac standstill, and then you revive with all the vigor and enthusiasm. The patient recovers, but left with a hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. And not to forget, hypertensive encephalopathy. If you look into all these conditions, there is no fever and the patient doesn't have headache. So, but what is common is the altered sensorium plus minus a seizure. So now how do you distinguish encephalopathy from encephalitis? Headache, as I said, is not present most of the encephalopathies, because headache and fever is symptom of itis, that is the inflammation. Altered sensorium in encephalopathy is fluctuating, because majority of these metabolic parameters, hypoglycemia, hepatic, renal, or even hyponatremia, you will find that patient was drowsy in the morning, he becomes unconscious in the evening, and next day morning he is again, sensorium is better. This sort of a fluctuating sensorium should alert the physician that you are dealing with a treatable condition. This is a very important clinical point. When a patient is admitted in a drowsy or unconscious state, when you see a fluctuating symptoms in the level of sensorium, that means there is some underlying cause which is treatable. Now, if there are seizures, encephalitis can be focal or generalized. Seizures are always generalized, whether it is hypoglycemia, hyponatremia. Neurodeficit obviously is not present. Metabolic parameters are abnormal. If you do a CSF examination, obviously encephalitis, it is abnormal, while in case of encephalopathy, it is normal. And similarly, EEG diffuse abnormality, here there may be focal or diffuse abnormality. Now, this table is very important in your clinical practice, because somebody comes with a fever and then has got involvement of the brain in the form of altered sensorium. You want to make sure whether it is a encephalitis or encephalopathy. How do you distinguish what we call as a septic encephalopathy, patient with a 104-105 temperature due to a urinary tract infection, may come with altered sensorium. So again, you look for, in case of neuro infection, there is a neck stiffness, there is a focal neuro deficit. CSF will be abnormal if it is neuro infection. As I mentioned to you, this is a very common clinical picture we see, elderly man admitted with altered sensorium, high fever. And then you will find that the fever is due to urinary tract infection. Whenever you are doubtful, a good CSF examination will distinguish whether it is a primary infection of the brain parenchyma. So, to put it in a nutshell, the difference between encephalopathy and encephalitis depends on the history, on the clinical findings, that is fever, headache, seizure, focal deficit, and ultimately the CSF, which will have a deciding factor after the clinical diagnosis. Now, this is a patient which I saw about last week, 65-year-old female diabetic, admitted for incoherent talk, unable to identify after waking up from sleep. She is conscious. So, is it a focal encephalitis? No fever, no seizures, no focal deficit. So, what is it? Encephalopathy, or is it a focal encephalitis? So the RBS, electrolytes, MR, brain, all was normal. But because the patient has acute onset, woke up from sleep and had this problem, little more examination of the language function showed that this patient had a sensory motor dysphasia. Sensory motor dysphasia of an acute onset. And it is a clinical diagnosis, because MR brain was normal. There may be very small infarct, which may not be seen at least for another 24 to 48 hours. Though MR brain is very sensitive, oftentimes in practice we see dense hemiplegia, MR scan normal. So don't be surprised if MR scan is normal when you have made a diagnosis clinically, because MR may follow the clinical diagnosis. So ultimately, pathy, encephalopathy and encephalitis, to distinguish, the final say is in the CSF analysis, which will tell us that the patient has a neuro infection or not. Nowadays, the CSF has got so many tests lined up. You may have to spend viral panel, bacterial panel, fungal panel, this, that, and all. It comes to about 25 to 30,000 rupees. So don't get enamored by that long list of CSF analysis. Look at what you are looking for. That is important. So clinically, you have made a diagnosis of acute viral encephalitis. All that you need is a routine protein, sugar, cells, gram stain, and there is a suspicion of carcinomatous, which we'll come to later, that one. Otherwise, no point in sending it for too many investigations. Now, how do you differentiate meningitis from encephalitis? In the initial slides, I told you only meningeal involvement as headache, fever, vomiting, neck stiffness. The moment the infection travels to the brain, then there is altered sensorium, seizures, and neurodeficit. CT or MR will show normal or meningeal enhancement, whereas some parenchyma lesion will be there. In CSF, the glucose is low in case of meningitis because it's acute bacterial meningitis. In encephalitis, it will be normal because most often it is viral. So the bacterial infection causes low glucose, the viral infection, normal glucose. There are a long list of viral disorders which can cause encephalitis. We used to see a lot of Japanese encephalitis. Now with the vaccination coming into picture, the incidence of Japanese encephalitis has come down. Then we have in Maharashtra some Chandipura virus. In children, we see mumps, measles and all. They are either para-infectious, that means along with viral infection, or post-infectious. Viral infection has come and gone, and then the neuroinfection starts. While the cause of acute encephalitis remains generally unknown in most cases, we don't really chase. There are a lot of viral parameters we can make out. But in clinical practice, what does it matter if it's an A virus or B virus or C virus, as long as we do not have any specific treatment. The only virus which has a specific treatment in terms of neuroinfection is the herpes simplex virus. So either a varicella zoster or herpes simplex is really important. So this is the usual picture in some of the cases of Japanese encephalitis, where you see the basal ganglia hyperintensity in MR scan, which can occur in other situation also. So the scan has to be interpreted on the diagnosis clinically made. Now, what is the management? As most of the acute viral encephalitis do not have any specific treatment. In clinical practice, whenever we find a patient has an acute viral encephalitis, by default, we start acyclovir, because if it is a herpes encephalitis, which has started as generalized encephalitis, because you might have missed the focal symptoms and signs in the history. If you delay, a treatable condition may become less treatable. So empirically, we start acyclovir, 10 mg per kg, infused over a period of 1 hour, because many times you find the acyclovir is running for 5 hours, 6 hours like that. It should be given within a period of 1 hour for adequate serum concentration to act on the virus. And then once you have excluded herpes simplex or varicella zoster, then you can withdraw acyclovir. Now, otherwise, all other viral encephalitis is symptomatic management, mannitol for cerebral edema, and anti-epileptic drugs if there is a seizure, if it is a post-infectious, steroids. So that is about the generalized encephalitis. Now, important to identify focal encephalitis, that is herpes simplex, autoimmune, and paraneoplastic. Herpes simplex, eminently treatable. Autoimmune, a good number can be treated well. Paraneoplastic, some of them can be treated. But remember, all are treatable conditions to some extent or largely. Now, how do you differentiate generalized encephalitis from focal encephalitis? Generalized encephalitis, remember acute GE encephalitis. The child is admitted or young adult is admitted with fever, headache, vomiting, seizures, and unconsciousness. So it is very acute. Whereas focal encephalitis, gradually the disease unfolds over a period of days or even 1 or 2 weeks. While in generalized encephalitis, altered sensorium is the benchmark for the diagnosis. In focal encephalitis, the patient is fully conscious with personality problems, psychiatric problems, and behavioral changes. Seizures are focal. There may be a neurodeficit of hemiparesis. Herpes simplex, as I said, herpes simplex, autoimmune, paraneoplastic are the three common causes of focal encephalitis, and there is a specific treatment available. In acute encephalitis, it's short-lived, maybe a few days, and then they may be left with a neurological deficit or they may completely recover. Whereas here, it is a prolonged, and the treatment also is prolonged. Now, herpes simplex encephalitis is a eminently treatable condition. I'm sorry, I'm repeating it again and again because my emphasis is always to look for a treatable disease, whether it is cardiology, neurology, or whatever. So when a patient is conscious with altered behavior and partial seizure, suspect, and then MR brain gives you an additional information that you are dealing with herpes simplex encephalitis, where there is a bitemporal involvement. EEG, CSF, and PCR or herpes simplex encephalitis antibody will further confirm. A clinical suspicion warrants immediate starting of acyclovir. What is it due to? It is supposed to be the reactivation of the virus, which is lying dormant in trigeminal ganglia. Important, if initial investigations are negative, we have suspected herpes simplex encephalitis, started acyclovir, MR scan normal, CSF shows inflammatory, but HSV was, PCR was negative. Repeat after 48 hours, you will see the MR scan has become positive or CSF has become positive. So only after repetition, if it is negative on two occasions, then only you withdraw the, this is the left temporal hyperintensity, but you can see in the right temporal also it is there. So in the MR scan, if you see bitemporal involvement, it is almost diagnostic of herpes encephalitis. But if you find the patient has only unilateral temporal involvement, then there is a differential diagnosis, glioma, tuberculoma, cysticercosis, so on, or even vascular involvement. But if you see bilateral temporal involvement at the same time, maybe asymmetric, it is almost diagnostic of herpes simplex encephalitis. Now look at this bitemporal involvement, one side more than the other, and the fact that there is an involvement on both sides is diagnostic. And also similarly, you will find in EEG, there is a unilateral seizure discharges, in this case from the left temporal. So please suspect focal encephalitis when there is a young adult or a middle-aged man comes with sudden onset of personality changes over a period of few days with focal seizures. Then you know that it is a focal disease. Get an MR scan, CSF, and start acyclovir immediately. Now, the recent one is an autoimmune. See, nowadays, if we have conquered many of the infectious diseases, treatable infectious diseases, now we are coming to non-communicable diseases, autoimmune. So multiple sclerosis, autoimmune. Myasthenia, autoimmune. Encephalitis, autoimmune. Peripheral neuropathy, autoimmune. So there are so many autoimmune disorders, and not to be left behind is the autoimmune encephalitis. Now, what are the clinical features? Here the autoimmune, that means the body's immune system kills its own cells, autoimmune. Mistakenly, instead of shooting the person who is your enemy, you shoot your own friend, and then they say, oh my God, how did I do it? And this antibodies, antigen antibody, can be on the surface of the neuron or it can be intracellular antibodies. And we have a long list of ha, he, hu, ru, NMDA and all that. And with every passing months or years, you will find more and more antibodies added to the list. So in my opinion, in clinical practice, because all these antibody tests will take you again another 20 to 25,000 rupees. But whether it is a WHO-HA or NMDA, ultimately you are going to give immunosuppressive treatment. So what I do in practice, where my patients cannot afford, on the basis of a focal progressive encephalitis and with an MR scan and CSF picture and a CSF showing the meningitis encephalitis findings, I start the treatment of the immunosuppression. Because ultimately that's what you will come to, whether it is X or Y or Z. Anyway, as a postgraduate student, you must be able to identify that there are surface antibodies. Out of these, the commonest is NMDA. And then there is an intracellular group antibodies. Out of that, RIV. So anti-NMDA and anti-V are commonly found in autoimmune encephalitis. Important is, in addition to focal seizures and hemiparesis, they come with a movement disorders, dystonia. So you find a man of 35, 40 with headache and altered behavior, personality of a short duration, 1 week or 8 days or 10 days, and has a intermittent dystonic movement of the hand, you can be almost certain that you are dealing with a autoimmune encephalitis. Now, management, symptomatic therapy for seizures and all, important is immunosuppressive therapy, where steroids, plasma exchange, and IVIG are the thing. Now, all immune-mediated disorders, whether it is MS or NMO or whether it is myasthenia or polymyositis, you will find that the standard procedure in acute management, steroids, as I keep telling you, steroids is like a Ganga Jal. Now I believe Ganges water has become very pure after the COVID-19 problem. So the government was spending crores of rupees to make Ganges clean. And a small tiny virus has made it cleaner than what was expected. So this is our Ganga Jal where we use for many medical disorders. So IV methylprednisolone, 1 gram daily for 5 days. Patient doesn't have any improvement, plasma exchange, and then IVIG. So you can repeat again another round of it. The patient doesn't have much improvement. Last side among the encephalitis is a paraneoplastic encephalomyelitis. So the very word paraneoplastic means, again here the patient has got focal encephalitis picture, but there is an underlying malignancy here. That is very important to discover that. And if you happen to do antibody panel, these anti-WHO antibodies are there, and 80% of them have small cell lung carcinoma, and the focal encephalitis precede the lung carcinoma. So the investigations, in addition to MR, EEG, and CSF, and all that cultures and viral panel and all, is to look for underlying cancer, because the treatment of the underlying carcinoma has got a better prognosis. So investigations are the standard three, MR brain, EEG, and CSF. Management, again, back to the same three immunosuppressive drugs with a tumor excision if one finds. Now we start with the next part of the neuroinfection, that is the meningitis. It can be an acute meningitis or a chronic one. We'll first start with the acute meningitis. It's one of my relative's daughter, 11-year-old female. She had a fever, body pain, headache, and vomiting. No next stiffness, no neurodeficit. An enthusiastic family doctor suspected it could be some meningitis, so he got a LP done. So they came with the report, 40 lymphocytes, normal sugar, normal protein. And I must tell you people that many of the non-neurologists, the moment they see a report of 10 lymphocytes, 20 lymphocytes, 30 lymphocytes, they immediately start on antitubercular drugs. It is an over-diagnosis based on the lymphocytes seen in this CSF. So similarly in this, because young girl of 11, so they started on antitubercular drug. Patient was completely neurologically intact, even the headache, fever and all is coming down. So we stopped the ATT, follow-up after 1 week and 1 month, asymptomatic. I have not repeated a CSF at all. So please remember, this is an acute viral meningitis. Very interesting. Acute viral meningitis is a benign condition and a self-limited. Unlike acute viral encephalitis, which has a lot of morbidity and mortality. Now, what does this mean? Investigation without a clinical diagnosis is like wearing a necktie without clothes. So the moment the patient is suspected, they do an MR scan, they do a CSF, and they treat the investigations, not the patient. So please remember, as I keep telling in my Wednesday class, clinical, clinical, and clinical impression. Now, acute bacterial meningitis is a very emergency number one in neurology. The usual headache, fever, vomiting, and all neck stiffness. If there is a meningococcal infection, there is a skin rash. Remember, in elderly patient with pneumococcal meningitis, there is no fever, no headache, and no neck stiffness. They just come with non-specific confusion. Now, it will also confuse the doctor because you do not know what we are looking at. So when you have no specific diagnosis in such a situation, we do resort to a lumbar puncture to look for an underlying neuroinfection. Remember, CSF examination is also a part of PUO examination, biopsy of unknown origin, or short history of a cerebral or meningeal pathology. 80 to 85% of them are community acquired, like pneumonia, meningococcal and hemophilus influenza. Hospital acquired is whether it is a head injury or neurosurgery or CSOM. The common pathogens, depending upon the age group, in neonates it may be E. coli. Meningococcal is very common in childhood, and pneumococcal again young adult. Gram-negative bacteria is common in elderly people, especially immunocompromised state. How do you differentiate in the CSF between bacterial meningitis and viral meningitis and chronic meningitis? Appearance is a very important one. Majority of the times you see a CSF report starting with protein sugar cells. Appearance is very important, because if the appearance is cloudy, you have to find out why is it cloudy. Is it because of raised protein, or is it because of a raised cell count? Only these two conditions can give rise to cloudy appearance. So this is a very important observation which must be written down in the report. In all other conditions, it may be clear. Protein will be normal in viral, sugar is normal, only the lymphocyte count never beyond 100 in viral infections. Bacterial meningitis, of course, it can be anything, and especially sugar will be very low. In chronic meningitis, proteins are much high, sugar is of course reduced, and lymphocytes are also increased. So to differentiate between acute and chronic, in acute it is a polymorph, in chronic it is a lymphocyte. So one can make a distinction between the different types of meningitis. Now let us see a couple of case scenarios. 13-year-old male with fever, headache, vomiting, altered sensorium. So you know that it is meningoencephalitis. So proteins 80, glucose 40, and 80 cells lymphocytes. So you are neither here nor there. Is it a viral infection or is it a tuberculous infection? Historically, it is viral because it is an acute onset. But in our country, tuberculosis can manifest in different ways. So it may be tuberculosis. So there may be a debate. So what do we do under this situation? Start antitubercular, but without steroids. Because steroids is a Ganga gel which will improve short-lived, even non-specifically. So please don't give steroids, just give antitubercular drugs and a repeat CSF a week later. This remarkable recovery in cell count is a viral meningitis, and patient also is clinically stable. You can stop antitubercular drugs. So this is the trick we use in our clinical practice to look for the CSF, because in tuberculous meningitis, cell count will not improve so fast within 1 week. It is a chronic meningitis, even if it is an acute manifestation. Treatment of acute bacterial meningitis, this is a usual community acquired, a quick and accurate diagnosis and appropriate antibiotics to be given in very high doses, always intravenous, no intramuscular, and minimum of 14 days of afebrile period. Commonly within a week, because patient is afebrile and he may be a little more conscious, we tend to withdraw that. It should not be done because we want all the bacteria to be eliminated. So 14 days of afebrile period. What drug to choose depends again on the age group, the third generation cephalosporin group, cefotaxime or ceftriaxone is the drug which is commonly used. The dosage must be quite high, as you can see here. When you suspect staph aureus, we always give vancomycin or linezolid, all for 3 weeks. Anaerobic bacterial infection, when you suspect from otitis media, add metronidazole and chloramphenicol. And always there is one Supreme Court antibiotic, that is the meropenem. In addition to this, the supportive therapy, anti-edema measures and anti-epileptic drugs. The earlier you make a diagnosis and start proper, appropriate treatment, the morbidity and mortality is less, but even then it is still high. So in neurology, it is an acute emergency number one, acute bacterial meningitis. Some questions about CSF. Should LP be done in a patient with altered sensorium? This is one of the common questions discussed in the wards. Patient is admitted in an unconscious state. You suspect meningitis or meningoencephalitis. You have done an MR scan, which is normal. There is no lateralizing lesions. Should we do or not do? Because there is a fear that in an unconscious patient, if you do a lumbar puncture, they may cone. So generally, if the MR scan doesn't show an edema, or if the patient is not in coma, then we give anti-edema measures and then do a lumbar puncture next day. In the intervening period, we start the appropriate treatment. Suppose you think the patient has got acute bacterial meningitis, you don't do an LP because it's an unconscious state, and you start the appropriate antibiotic according to the age group and all. And once the anti-edema measures take place, mannitol, next day you can do a lumbar puncture and then make the confirmation of the diagnosis. That is number one. Next is, should we do a LP first or an MR scan first or a CT available? Patient is admitted with fever, headache, vomiting, unconscious. Clinically, you suspect it is meningitis. Should we do a CT or a LP first? If you are going to do both, then do imaging first. If there is no facility to do an imaging, and you may do a lumbar puncture. Because in imaging, if you find patient has an abscess with meningitis, then it is risky to do a lumbar puncture. Some people say that we'll do a very cautious lumbar puncture. There is nothing like cautious lumbar puncture. I usually say that if there is a balloon with water, whether you put a knife or whether you put a pin, as it starts leaking, the balloon will collapse. So you may do a lumbar puncture, take out a lot of CSF. The patient may cone and die in the next 1 hour. So they may say doctor did a LP and patient died. If you take a 24 or 26, I mean 26 needle and just take out 5 ml, the patient may die in the night. Then you may not get a blame. But there's nothing like a cautious lumbar puncture. Antibiotics before LP. It won't change the CSF findings, sugar, cell count and all that, but they may reduce the chances of cultivating the bacteria. But patient is important. So suppose the LP is to be done next morning, why I'm going to tell you later, then don't wait for LP to tell the patient has acute bacterial meningitis. Start the antibiotics. Should LP be repeated? Absolutely no. If the patient is clinically improving, don't try to see whether CSF is improving or not. You are treating a patient, not the CSF. So if the patient is improving, there is no need to repeat LP. If the patient is not improving, then you may have to repeat LP to revise your diagnosis. The last question, is there a need to do blood glucose before LP? Yes, especially in diabetics. See, normally the CSF glucose is 2/3 of serum glucose. Okay. So suppose the patient is RBS in diabetes 250 mg before you did a lumbar puncture, the CSF comes as 80 mg. If you just read only CSF glucose, you think it is normal? Yes. But if you compare it with 250 mg, it is definitely low. So a random blood sugar should be done before doing a lumbar puncture and then interpreted whether it is normal or not. When the CSF returns to normalcy, it is always the cell count which becomes less, and then the glucose, and lastly the protein. Corticosteroids, acute bacterial meningitis. Yes, earlier we used to downgrade the general practitioners who used to give steroids in acute bacterial meningitis. But then we came back and changed. You see, medicine is ever changing like fashion. Now we say that give first steroids in Haemophilus influenza children and then give the antibiotics and continue steroids for 48 hours. This is because if the bacteria die, they release their endotoxins which can cause severe cerebral edema, which can complicate the issue. And so the steroids for 48 hours starting first, followed by antibiotics, particularly in Haemophilus influenza in children. But in adult bacterial meningitis, we don't use steroids. For edema, we use mannitol. Now we move on to the chronic meningitis. In our country, still the commonest cause of chronic meningitis or subacute is TBM, followed by cryptococcal, and with increasing detection of cancer, carcinomatous meningitis is the third common cause which we see in clinical practice, and others are less common. In our country, any diagnosis of chronic meningitis is TBM unless you have an alternative diagnosis. So once you make a diagnosis of chronic meningitis, start antitubercular. If you find it is due to cryptococcal or carcinomatous, then only you withdraw. Clinical features of meningitis, like any other meningitis, headache, fever, neck stiffness. When it involves the cortex, then there is a seizures, and then there are focal symptoms and signs and altered sensorium. Now, we do the same three investigations, MR scan, CSF, and EEG. So, MR scan may show meningeal enhancement in pure meningitis. If there is an involvement of the parenchyma, it can also show the parenchyma lesions. The CSF will show lymphocyte predominance, and the protein may be very high, glucose is less. You send them for India Inc. Zn stain and PCR for antibody, cryptococci. Nowadays we have gene expert, and ultimately culture and sensitivity. Remember, both aerobic and anaerobic has to be done, because the next common diagnosis of chronic meningitis is a cryptococcal, so we need to do an anaerobic culture also. Tissue biopsy occasionally for fungal meningitis like mucormycosis. Now, CSF analysis is the gold standard for neuroinfection. All through, the emphasis is on brain, altered sensorium, altered behavior, seizures, and focal neurological deficit. Meninges, headache, neck stiffness. But ultimately, neuroinfection is equal to CSF. So CSF is the gold standard for diagnosis of neuroinfection. In fact, in today's clinical practice, CSF is very rarely done unless it is a neuroinfection. Never diagnose meningitis on MR scan, because I have seen this happening. So please remember CSF, CSF, and CSF. And we have the standard appearance, as I told you, protein, sugar cells, malignant cells. There are special tests, the PCR antibody, tuberculosis, cysticercosis, cryptococci. And there is a panel of viral panel, bacterial panel, fungal panel. So you give them 3 cc of CSF, they give you some 30 results in that. But remember the cost, 25,000 rupees. In clinical practice, it is important to look for meningeal reaction can occur due to inflammation without infection. Blood, subarachnoid blood, or intracerebral bleed, or even stroke cerebral infarction, when the blood leaks from the cerebral infarction which is on the surface, when it leaks into the CSF, subarachnoid space, the blood is a highly irritant. So the CSF throws out cells and a slight increase in protein, but the sugar remains normal. So that is a very important one. I'll tell you a couple of cases which I've seen. A 63-year-old male, hypertensive, woke up with right hemiplegia. So you know that diagnosis is a right hemiplegia stroke. In addition to hemiplegia, he had a headache and neck stiffness. When he came to the hospital 2 days later, MR brain showed a left vertebral, or there's something wrong here, left vertebral cerebral, it should be, sorry, left cerebral infarction. Protein showed increased protein, normal sugar, and 45 lymphocytes. So elsewhere, the diagnosis was TBM with hemiplegia. It is like egg first or chicken first. So because there is a, see, the moment you see a cell count for a non-neurologist, oh, this is TB meningitis. So hemiplegia is known in TB meningitis. But remember, in TB meningitis, hemiplegia comes much later as a complication of TBM vasculitis. But here, the clinical story is an acute right hemiplegia, which is a stroke. So why the CSF is abnormal? It is a reaction of the meninges to the blood. So it is not a reaction of, it is a reaction of the meninges. It is not a TBM. Hemiplegia with CSF changes, not TBM with hemiplegia. Why did you make a different diagnosis? The clinical evolution. Back to clinical neurology. Can we confirm it? Yes. Repeat a CSF a week later. It is almost normal CSF without anti-tubercular drugs. So there is another patient whom we saw. Patient was admitted for headache, vomiting, neck stiffness, no fever, no seizures. So because there is a neck stiffness, MR brain normal, CSF was xanthochromic with a protein 80. So this xanthochromic alerted that it is a old blood. Then when we went back to the history, 2 weeks earlier, patient had an abrupt onset of a severe headache, vomiting. So that was a small subarachnoid bleed. The blood has now converted into xanthochromia. So it is not TB meningitis again, because the moment you say lymphocytes, you say it is a TB meningitis. Subsequently, the DSA showed a posterior communicating artery aneurysm. Throughout this talk, CSF is hogging the limelight. Obviously, because neuroinfection is confirmed by CSF examination, because it's the most important. CSF analysis is the gold standard for diagnosis of neuroinfection, which is very obvious. But please remember, the gold itself needs to be tested for purity and reliability. There we go. Pitfalls of CSF analysis. It should be non-traumatic CSF. This is a must. Otherwise, whatever values are there in the blood, it seeps into the CSF. Even, for example, in MS, when we look for oligoclonal bands, the serum oligoclonal bands should be compared with CSF. Otherwise, the same serum will come into the CSF. And if you say CSF is positive, it doesn't become MS. So it should be a clear non-traumatic CSF. Bloodstained CSF has got misleading. Important, cell count should be done within 60 minutes because the cells will start degenerating, dying. So if you do an LP at 4 p.m. today, the lab is closed. Tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, it will be analyzed. So 200 polymorphs would have become 10 polymorphs. And you would say, well, this is not bacterial meningitis. Do you remember this? It should be done within 60 minutes. Even glucose level, they go down within 2 to 3 hours. So it is important that CSF should be done immediately within 1 hour. From the time of puncture, it is something like our window period for thrombolysis. It should be as much as that. The reason is people do a lumbar puncture at 4 p.m. and then next morning only the report will be analyzed. So CSF should reach the lab within 30 minutes. Whenever CSF report is crucial for diagnosis, you have done an LP today and then you are not sure what is happening, please repeat an LP again. Because this is another problem with non-neurologists. Problem in the sense they feel doing an LP while the patients are ready to undergo CABG. But if you say we have to do LP, they are damn scared of it. So that is a myth. So repeat LP must be done next morning. Take the CSF yourself to the lab and find out the analysis as quickly as possible. In a bloodstained CSF, how to differentiate traumatic CSF from hemorrhagic CSF? Traumatic CSF clears as the CSF flow is continuing. The first tube may be blood, second tube may be pink, third tube it gets clear. And then the first tube, which is bloodstained, if you spin it, the RBCs will settle down, leaving the superficial clear CSF. If it is a old blood, then you'll see superficial xanthochromia. When should LP be performed as an urgent investigation? The patient is admitted at 3 p.m. Sir, it is a TB, a chronic meningitis TBM. Shall I do an LP? I said, check the lab whether they are there to do it. No, they are not there. The person in charge has gone out. Do it tomorrow. What is the emergency? So, an acute indication for LP is a bacterial meningitis, because that is the one where you have to start immediately the treatment. But as I said, the patient is unconscious, you may start the treatment and then do an LP next morning. Now, CSF is also helpful to know what are these granulomas, because this is a coalescing granuloma like tuberculosis, and or there may be a thick exudate here. So it, CSF is helpful to know what is happening in the brain also, but we'll have to correlate the two. Now this is a cysticercus cyst, a small one there, which can also cause cysticercal meningitis. I'm proceeding because I want you to ask me some questions. Now the differentiation between cysticercus and tuberculosis meningitis. In tuberculosis, there are constitutional symptoms, neurological deficit may be there, and definite evidence of meningitis may be there, TBM like. In cysticercosis, all of them are not there. Patient has got a less than 20 millimeter size single lesion. More than 20 millimeters is a tuberculosis lesion. Now what about the tuberculosis? Before it becomes 20 millimeters, it should be 10 millimeters also. So whenever you are in doubt, you treat it as cysticercosis, because it is a short-term treatment of 21 days. And if the patient does not improve radiologically, clinically, then you may start tuberculosis treatment. Primary drugs in the TB meningitis. The four drugs, INH, rifampin, and all that you are aware. Now, this is one more point. You see that INH and rifampin have got a very good CSF penetrance and or bactericidal. So this is a very important drug. That's why we give these two drugs for 1 to 1.5 years in TB meningitis. Whereas PZA has got a good CSF penetrance, better than rifampin, but it is a bacteriostatic. So we use it for first 3 months. So we use two bacteriostatic drugs along with two bactericidal drugs, four drugs for 3 months, and then these two drugs for another 9 months. That is the standard treatment for anti-tubercular drugs, whether it is a TBM or whether it is a tuberculoma. Now the patient's late complications can be hydrocephalus. Now, a 28-year-old male diagnosed as TBM, doing well, asymptomatic. Since 3 weeks, has become dull, apathetic, headache, no fever. No physical findings. Suspect hydrocephalus as a long-term complication. And you find the patient as a hydrocephalus. So the patient may require a shunt tube at that time. So the conclusions are, neuroinfections are eminently treatable conditions. If recognized early, treated appropriately, mortality and morbidity can be reduced. While CSF analysis is the cornerstone for diagnosis, the interpretation should be in the clinical context. And there are so many pitfalls in the CSF analysis which you should recognize. Don't jump to conclusions just by looking at the report of 40 cells or 80 cells like that. So there are times where you get a report as 150 polymorphs. You don't suspect a bacterial meningitis. You go back and check. They're all RBCs, but the technician has reported it as polymorphs. So there are many pitfalls. Please try to understand the basic concepts.